Kanada Toronto Üniversitesi'nden Yakın ve Orta Doğu Medeniyetleri bölümünden Sayın Muhammed Rüstem diyorum. Rüstem demiyorum. Ben Türkçeleştiriyorum. Profesör Doktor, kendisine mikrofonu bırakıyoruz. Buyurun efendim.
All right, thank you very much. I wanted to just begin with a saying in Arabic because my good friend Professor Yücel had really spoken from the heart. There's a wonderful saying in Arabic. It says al-kalimat idha sadarat min al-qalb waqa'at fi al-qalb wa idha sadarat min al-lisan lam tujawwiz al-udhnayn. That is when words come from the heart, they hit the heart. But when they come from the tongue, they do not even pass the ears. So thank you very much for speaking from the heart. Now, I have a dilemma. I have a little bit of a problem. And basically, I'll let you in on it. In the Islamic tradition, you're not supposed to speak in front of your teachers. And my problem is I have several of my esteemed teachers in the audience here, and I'm very shy to speak in front of them without some kind of nod from them to allow me to continue. All right, thank you. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. I would like to offer some remarks on the notion of love in the Sufi tradition. Since I'm not a specialist in Turkish Sufism, I will not dare venture into explaining what Haji Behram Vali has to say about the topic. Well, at least not right away. Rather, I will focus most of my attention on someone with whom I am more familiar and who no doubt is also familiar to all of you, namely Mevlana. So through the lens of Mevlana, I shall attempt to address the question of love. But having cleared the ground in a sense, I will eventually turn to Haji Behram, whose barakah permeates this city and which undoubtedly allows someone so unworthy as myself to speak about so exalted a topic as love. I will first begin with a seemingly simple and straightforward question. What, according to Mevlana, is love? From his perspective, inquiring into the nature of love can only give one partial answers, since the very inquiry into what love is itself entails a partial question. The easiest way for Mevlana to explain what love is to say that we will know what it is when we get there. Consider these lines. He says, "Someone asked, 'What is love?' I said, 'Do not ask about these meanings. When you become like me, you will see. When you are invited by it, you will sing of it.'" Thankfully, Mevlana himself left behind nearly 65,000 verses of poetry which sing of the nature and reality of love. Yet even after having attained to love, he acknowledges that things are better left unsaid, precisely because love is too vast to be encompassed by human thought and language. He says in the following poem, "Whatever I say about love by way of commentary and exposition, when I get to love, I am ashamed at that. Although explanation with the tongue is clear, that love which is tongue-less is even clearer. Herçigu yam eşk ra şerhu bayan, çumbe eşk ayam hecel manem ezan. Gerçi tefsir-i zeban roşen gerast, lik eşke bi zeban roşen terast." Since love is so difficult to pin down, Mevlana finds an apt metaphor for what it is by referring to it as an ocean, which incidentally he does more so than any other poet in the Persian or Arabic language. The image of an ocean as an all-embracing entity furnishes Mevlana with ample material in order for him to convey the vastness of love. He says, for example, "Love cannot be contained in speaking and listening. It is an ocean whose bottom cannot be plumbed. The drops of the ocean cannot be counted. Before that ocean, the seven seas are mud." Love, therefore, is a fathomless ocean, one which cannot be encompassed by an individual because of the finitude of the human situation. Yet the picture is much more nuanced than this. There is a reason why human beings cannot explain love. The reason, Mevlana tells us, lies in the secret of the reality of love. It is nothing other than the basis of our existence. And since the individual instantiations of existence cannot encompass the more general scope of existence, so too can the individual instantiations of love do nothing more than grope at the reality of the more general scope of love. Love, in other words, is tantamount to saying existence or even life. Mevlana says, "Love is the ocean of life which has no bottom. The least of its gifts is eternal life." If love is the basis of life for Mevlana, There is a good reason for why he says this. Amongst the many names of God to be found in the Quran is the living, Al-Hayy, and the lover, Al-Wadud. Hence, if life and love are equated by Mevlana, it is because God the living is also God the lover. As the lover who is alive, God thus has objects of love, which is to say that God can be called a lover when there are people that he can love. This means the quest for love is not a one-sided affair. God is sought after by his servants, but he also seeks after them. With this in mind, it would be a good idea to turn to a famous hadith to be found in many Islamic sources, known as the hadith or hadith of the hidden treasure. It is reported that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi said that God told him, "I was a hidden treasure and I love to be known, so I created the universe that they may know me." Without delving into all the metaphysical implications of this particular tradition, it is important to keep in mind that mention of God as the hidden treasure who loved to share himself has nothing to do with the deficiency on God's part. Rather, it has to do with the fact that God, out of his infinite bounty and love, desired to share himself so that he could see himself in the mirror of the cosmos in an objective manner, and thus not only in a purely subjective manner. That is to say that in order for God to actualize the infinite possibilities and plenitude found within himself, he created the universe so that he could see himself in one of the many modes of his own self-perception. Let us turn to a more concrete example. It was just stated that God is sought by his servants and that he seeks them. This point is best illustrated by Mevlana when he draws on the image of thirst and by extension belonging. Since love is a two-way street, the thirsty may seek water, which is a symbol of life and love, two of God's qualities. But water also seeks the thirsty, since without water having someone to thirst after it, it cannot be called water. So Mevlana says, "The thirsty man laments, 'O sweet water.' The water," and I just was thirsty, so I drank. "The water also laments, 'Where is the water drinker?' This thirst in our souls is the attraction of the water. We belong to it, and it belongs to us. Since we belong to God, he also belongs to us. That means that since we have life, we have a share in what God is, namely life. And since we can love and do love, we have another share in what God is, namely love itself. At the same time, God seeks us out in the very relationships that he sets up as a part of the human drama of existence. We are expected to work with God if we want to arrive at his door. And the surest way to do that is to realize that the water of which Mevlana speaks is there to quench our thirst, and that it actively wants to provide us with the nourishment which we seek. That is to say that God is not a passive player in our lives. Rather, he is both the goal and, paradoxically, the means to that goal. What is required on the human side is to have the right kind of preparedness or spiritual sensitivity, which Mevlana calls thirst, teshnegi. The duality that Mevlana seems to be positing here may somewhat appear alarming for some of us. But Mevlana, in keeping with the Sufi tradition in general, is careful not to posit the servant-God relationship on the same ontological plane. That is, he does not see God and humans as two equal players in the game of love. Rather, human beings, when they have truly understood their role as lovers, lose themselves completely in the object of their love. It is from this perspective that we can meaningly speak of God as both a subject and object of love. Mevlana, it will be recalled, defined love as the ocean of life. This is from the perspective of God. Yet from the perspective of humans, it is more fitting to call love the ocean of non-existence, Daryaya Adam. Hence, Mevlana says, "What then is love? The ocean of non-existence. It is here that the foot of the intellect is broken. Pas esh chabao shad daryaya adam, dar shikhasta unja aghl ra qadam." But if love is the ocean of non-existence, then why bother with it? That is, what does it mean to call love the ocean of non-existence? And why should human beings devote themselves to something that is not? As a provisional answer, and one that will become clearer in due course, it can be noted that Mevlana is not trying to say that love is non-existent in reality, or that love is somehow that which leads to non-existence. Rather, love is the ocean of non-existence on the human side of the equation, because after having delved into the ocean of love, which is the root of non-existence for Mevlana, since it is nothing other than God, the living lover, one's own qualities, self-perception, and ego cease to be. That is, the ego overtaken by the tidal waves of love becomes completely annihilated in the face of love's waters and thus comes to be non-existent. What subsists is not the individual ego, but the soul transformed by the power of love so that it can dwell in the sacred presence of God, not as an individual I that is separate from God, but an I that is wholly indistinguishable from the ocean. In other words, once the individual waves of the ocean ebb back into the ocean, they lose their individual properties and return to their source, which is the divine ocean. It is at this moment that all traces of duality disappear, and it's from this perspective that such Quranic passages as Surah 8, verse 17 are to be understood. And the verse reads in English, "And you did not throw when you threw, but God threw." وَمَا رَمَيْتَ إِذَا رَمَيْتَ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ رَمَى. But how do we attain to this state? In answering this question, Mevlana says that something has to take place within the knowing subject. There needs to be an entire transformation of the individual's being so that it can come to perceive things the way they truly are. How this is done, Mevlana insists, is by accessing the heart. In one of his most touching poems, he encourages people to turn to their true selves, namely their hearts. He says, "O heart, return to yourself, for from the heart a hidden road can be found to the beloved. If in the world of the six directions there is no door, when you come to the heart, you can make a door. Come into the heart, the place of contemplating God. Although this may not be the case now, it can be made to be so." One of the debated etymologies of the term Sufi is that it comes from an Arabic root which means pure. Thus, a Sufi is an active and reflective form of this root, which is to say that a Sufi is one who purifies his inner self. He no longer clings on to books and to formal learning, since that is a quality specific to the partial intellect only, aql juzvi. The pen of the scholar is thus no match for the heart of the Sufi. This is because the authority that comes with the spiritual life derives from following those spiritual masters who have withstood the test of time and who have entered the divine presence, only to return to show others how to follow their way. The scholar or the person devoted to the partial intellect only, on the other hand, only follows that formal kind of knowledge available through books written by people who are also dominated by the partial intellect. As Mevlana says, "The book of the Sufi is neither of ink nor letters. It is nothing other than a white heart like snow. The provisions of the scholar are the traces of the pen. What are the Sufi's provisions? Traces from the footsteps of the Evliya. Daftar Sufi savad o harf nist, juz dil aspid hamchun barf nist, saz danishmand asar qalam, saz Sufi chist asar qadam." The purity of the Sufi is due to his constant remembrance of God. The more he remembers God, the more he comes to know him. And the more he comes to know him, the more he comes to love him. This is why the act of polishing the mirror of the heart is the key into entering into a love relationship with God. The Sufi's heart, in other words, is like white snow because of its purity, which it has arrived at through the remembrance of God and through following his friends or saints, Avliya. Turning our attention back to the image of the ocean of non-existence, Mevlana explains that the heart that is pure not only heads towards the ocean, but it also becomes a part of it. He says, "That heart has become clean and pure from mud. It has become excellent and complete. It has cast the mud aside and come towards the ocean. Free from the prison of mud, it has become of the ocean." In one important tale, Mevlana seeks to illustrate this idea in a more concrete way. He tells the story of a naked man who jumps into the water in order to escape the stings of a bunch of bees who had been chasing him and would not relent in their efforts to attack him. The man thus jumps into the water in order to escape them. But since he cannot sustain being submerged in water for too long, he resurfaces for air only to find the bees waiting for him to resume their assault. The same story, the story sheds light on an important point, namely that the bees represent our remembrance for things in this world, while the water represents the act of remembering God. When the soul flees from his remembrance of things in this world and actively seeks to remember and invoke God's name, he is safe from remembering that which distracts him from his goal, which is to say that he is momentarily safe from the shackles of the world which pin him down and cause him to forget his true home. But since he is not submerged in the water completely, since he has not become drowned in it, he sticks his head out back from the water for what he perceives to be a breath of fresh air, only to realize that that thing from which he was safe is now again there to assail him. The solution, Mevlana says, is to become absorbed in the water and to drown completely in it. He says, the water is the remembrance of God, while at this moment, the bees are the remembrance of so-and-so a woman and so a man. In the water of remembrance, hold your breath and be patient, so that you may be released from reflections and whisperings of old. After that, you yourself will entirely take on the nature of that pure water, head to foot. It is key that Mevlana speaks of the one who has drowned in the water of the remembrance of God as gaining the nature of that pure water, head to foot. So characterized does he become by the object of his quest that he actually becomes it, and it can be said it becomes him. In the light of Mevlana's reference to love as the ocean of non-existence, we can thus see how the tale of the man who fled from the bees provides us with a framework to understand what Mevlana was trying to say. Extinguished by the remembrance of God, the person with the pure heart is no longer there, as his ego has been wiped away, along with the stains of forgetfulness that taint the mirror of his heart. All that is in his heart is the object of his desire and love, namely God. So dominated has he become with the remembrance of his friend that he has lost himself in the act of remembrance. Thanks to the constant remembrance of God, the waves of love for other than God have resided, and all things have ebbed back into the ocean of love. We can thus conceive of true love in a number of ways. It can be the water of life, or even the ocean of non-existence. But Mevlana also describes love using an image quite contrary to that of water, namely fire. He tells us in many instances in his writings that love is like a fire which, when it takes hold of the one who comes into contact with it, totally consumes him and renders him to ashes. All that remains when the fire is done its business is the source of that fire, that is the divine beloved itself. He says, love is that flame which, when it blazes up, burns away everything except the beloved. And in an autobiographical poem that is often attributed to Mevlana, he drives home this point. He says, the sum of my life is three words no more. I was raw, I was cooked, I was burned. Hasle umram se sukhan bish nist, kham budam pokhte shodam sukhtam. Now I would like to turn my attention, as promised, to Haji Behram Veli. Looking over Haji Behram's poetry as generously translated by Victoria Holbrook, one particular set of lines stood out to me. I thus would like to conclude my lecture with the meditation upon some of Haji Behram's words with respect to the theme of fire and burning. In doing so, I hope to demonstrate how, although Haji Behram and Mevlana were over 100 years apart on the outward plane, they were indeed united on the inward plane, as they were both annihilated in the same all-consuming fire of love. In lines of elegant and supple beauty, Haji Behram sings, what of this heart of mine, it grieves and aches for you, this heart of mine. Here, Haji Behram speaks of the agony or pain of love. A major theme in Sufi writings is that affliction is a positive thing, that it is there in order to bring about certain changes within our souls, which would not have been possible had those afflictions not visited us. Like salt that is sprinkled on meat in order to tenderize the meat and actualize its true nature, so too does affliction visit human beings in order to take them beyond their current situation and into the arms of their beloved. This kind of affliction, which is total and all-consuming, usually comes about after one has dedicated himself to partial loves, that is, love for other than God. These partial loves might engender within the person the thought that these partial loves actually lead to a state of misery. By misery, of course, I mean that kind of agony of spirit that afflicts the human being when he comes to see himself as lacking the true object of love, namely the divine beloved. The very affliction of life thus becomes equated with one's burning desire to be with God. Night and day, the lover yearns for his beloved. This explains why, having seen the world and its partial loves for what they really are, Haji Behram speaks of his grief and heartache for God. In other words, it is only God who can satisfy the seeker totally, because beneath the ephemeral veil called the world is the one thing most needful, as Christ says. Whereas all things perish and wither away, God does not, as he is the very root of the existence of these things. The center of the human being is his heart, or what can also be called the seat of man's consciousness. Since God is at the heart of all things and is the center of all things, he is also at the center of the human being, which is why the mystics often speak of God as the human being's divine center. This also explains why the Prophet of Islam said that the heart of the believer is the throne of the All-Merciful, قلب المؤمن عرش الرحمن. God thus resides within us at the very core of our being. Yet the divine heart dweller's presence is often obscured by the rust and dross which taints our hearts. Envisioning the spiritual path as a journey in love, the more the aspirant travels along the way, the deeper in love he becomes with the object of his love, which is none other than the divine beloved himself. Thus, we can say that the thick crust of the human ego slowly strips away the more one becomes consumed in the fire of love. When one reaches the goal of the path, namely God himself, the heart of the human being, namely what he is completely burnt in the fire of love. This being burnt is not a negative quality, however. Haji Bayram alludes to this, it seems, when he says that his heart, being burnt, is dyed with love's color. To quote him, he says, it may be burned, but yet it's dyed with love's color, this heart of mine. The color of love is no color, just as the locus of love, namely the heart, is no place.
Pardon, Monsieur Mohamed, pardon. Je suis obligé d'alerter, je m'excuse. Vous avez 5 minutes seulement.
I have one.
Oui, continue.
Thank you. Let's just read the poem for Haji Bayram again. He says, about the heart, he says, it may be burned, but yet it's dyed with love's color, this heart of mine. Now, as I was mentioning, the color of love is no color, just as the locus of love, namely the heart, is no place. God, being the placeless, the nameless, and the colorless, leaves all things in their naked reality. For Haji Bayram, his heart is so consumed by the divine fire of love that it is burnt to the point of extinction. The ego has been burnt away, and his underlying substance, insofar as there is a separative kind of existence from God, is also burnt and annihilated. And all that remains for Haji Bayram is his divine center, his placeless, nameless, and colorless heart. Thank you.
Peki, Sayın Muhammed'e gönülden teşekkür ediyoruz. Kur'an-ı Kerim'de geçen Esma-ül Hüsna'da iki tanesi üzerinde durdu. Hay ve Vedud üzerinde durdu. Konuşmasının üçte ikisini Mevlana'ya yoğunlaştırdı. Son üçte birini Hacı Bayram Veli'ye yönelttiler. Ben de bu arada tabii ki ayetleri Arapça, Farsça, ayet, hadisler birbirine karıştı. Mükemmel bir bütünlük arz etti. Cenab-ı Hak da buyuruyor ki malumumuz hepimizin, biz her şeyi sudan yarattık, canlı olan her şeyi sudan yarattık diye buyuruyor. Suyun kıymetini vurguladılar. Burada bir terimi güzel, hoşumuza gitti. Derya-yı Adem, yokluk olarak kullandılar. Sineye vurgu yaptılar. Kendisine çok teşekkür ediyoruz. Bundan sonra Mevlana haftası devam ediyor. 17'si de bitiyor. Dolayısıyla Mevlana'dan dem vurduğu için bir sözüyle de ben oturumu kapatacağım. Tabii ödülleri vereceğiz. Kendisinin ayrıca Cemal Nur Sargut Hanımefendi'ye özel bir sunumları, hatıra bir hediyeleri olacak sanıyorum. Öyle bir bilgi ulaştı bana. Ona imkanı tanıyacağız. Hacı Bayram malumunuz buyuruyor. Men bende-i Kur'anem eger candarem, men lehi rah-ı pak-ı Muhammed muhtarem. Arz ederim, saygılar sunuyorum. Buyurun Tülin Hanım, mikrofon sizin.
Teşekkür ederim efendim. Geldim zaten, yerimi aldım efendim. Şimdi, hocam da söyledi, ben de zaten hocam söylemeden önce de bunu düşünüyordum. Şimdi Kanada'dan, Toronto'dan Muhammed Rüstem gelmiş, hoş gelmiş, sefalar getirmiş. Mevlana'dan ne güzel bir su verdi bize, değil mi? Böyle bir içtik ki kana kana içtik. Şebi Arus'tayız. Bayram öyle olmaz. Bayram İsa Bey, biz bazen giyinir süslenir parklara da gideriz. Gönlümüz bayram eder ama vücuda da lazım. Dil de lazım, beden de lazım, mal da lazım, onların da bayram etmesi lazım. Bize bu Kanada'dan getirdiği su için Muhammed Rüstem'e de Az teşekkür etmiyoruz. Şebiyoruz'a epey yaraştı. Teşekkür ediyoruz. Ama onun da teşekkürü varmış hocama.
Evet, buyursun. Evet. Buraya teşrifinizi arz ediyoruz Sayın Cemal Nur Sarıkut Hanımefendi. Misafirimizin...
Günün anısına şiltleri de hocam siz lütfettiniz, siz verin lütfen. Ve o şekilde bitirelim bu oturumu.
Efendim bu tasavvufi neşveyle muazzam bir ilim sundu bize ve benim acizane Semih Bey'e bir gönülden borcum var. Diyorum ki tasavvuf büyüklerini böylesine birleştiren, aslında hakikatin bu kadar tek olduğunu ilimle açıklayan kendisine gönlümle teşekkür ediyorum. Allah ondan razı olsun. Gönüllü anlattınız Hacı Bayram'ı. Biz de inşallah söylediklerinize layık olalım efendim. Efendim ben Oxford'da keşfettim oğlumu. Onunla bir gönül bağımız oluştu. Muazzam bir konuşma yapmıştı Oxford'da. İbn Arabi Hazretleri'nin Razi'ye yazdığı mektubu Oxford'da anlattı. İbn Arabi'nin bu işler gönül işleridir, keşif işleridir, felsefe işi değildir diye anlattığı o mektubu Oxford'da okudu ve anlattı. Ben kendisine buradaki sunumu için, oradaki sunumu için bu kadar güzel İslam mutasavvıflarını anladığı ve anlattığı için teşekkürler ediyorum. Gelecekte de başarılar diliyorum.